I'm Keith Ghostland, and this is our holiday show.
I'm Ann Charles.
I'm Linda Quinlan. It's December 18th, Tuesday, and welcome to All Things LGBTQ. So,
is now the time?
Yes.
Okay.
So, all right.
To talk about local and regional events, I'm going to share a bit of a recent meeting that happened in Worcester, Massachusetts. Look at the correct camera, which was the first New England-wide meeting of LGBTQ activists. Phenomenal day. And then we've recently had meetings with the Human Rights Commission in the Office of the Governor. I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of the things that we were talking about and that we're going to be following.
I have some international headlines. There are many of them. The UN moves, I'm starting out with some sad, unpleasant headlines.
And I'm putting my hat back on.
No, that's part of the reason we took our hats off. The UN moves LGBT plus refugees to safe houses in Kenya after camp attacks. Athens police charged in fatal attack on gay activist. I'd like to return to the 1988 death of an Australian gay man, and I have a story that contextualizes that. Good news, German Parliament approves third gender option. Israel's top court rules for gay parents in a birth certificate fight. A trans drama called Girl was wowed at Cannes but criticized in the U.S. And we'll talk a little about that. I have more positive news that will be accompanied by pictures. First of all, Ben Hout is announced as the first LGBT correspondent for BBC News. So we have a picture of him. Next, I'd like to show you a picture of Miss Universe's first transgender contestant. She revels in being a role model. Her name is Angela Ponce. She's Miss Spain. Observe her picture. Unfortunately, she lost to Miss Philippines, but nevertheless, it was a great stride, and we'll talk a little about her if we have time. Mel Reed, a six-time ladies Euro Tour champ, reveals that she's gay. She's a golfer, and you see the picture before you of her teeing up. Her message to her fans is be proud of who you are. I have one more picture for you of Dr. Obi Ezekwelili from Nigeria. She's a presidential candidate who says, I'll support lesbian and gay rights if I'm elected. Two more stories I'm not going to get to. Bermuda, seriously? Bermuda appeals same-sex marriage to the Privy Council.
Oh, you're joking.
Croatian activists to challenge a law barring gay couples from fostering children. We'll have more about these stories in future broadcasts. But those are the headlines.
All right. And the headlines from the national news. The Boy Scouts are on the verge of bankruptcy. Sexual abuse settlements could force the once anti-LGBTQ organization into Chapter 11. Mary Queen of Scots. Mike Pence is weaponizing language against LGBTQ people. Bohemian Rhapsody makes history as the highest grossing music biopic of all time.
Biopic.
Is it a biopic?
It's a biopic.
Okay. Ann Coulter slams exotic sexual groups and college queers in a new low for even her. Detroit pastor charged with trans woman's murder. Sarah Silverman promises she's done with using gay in her comedy. And Ellen DeGeneres may quit her talk show. So
that was a whole mess of, yeah. So last week, I went to the first New England-wide meeting of LGBTQ activists in Worcester, Mass. It was sponsored by GLAAD, Gay, Lesbian Advocates and Defender, and the Equality Federation. 35 activists from around New England, Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut. It was an amazing day. It was the first time we had activists in the same room at the same time talking about the work that we're doing and looking to each other for, oh, you want to work on parenting issues. We did a parentage bill last year. Let us share the language with you, and let us tell you where it is that we stubbed our toes, or what it is that our opposition was putting forward. And then there was a conversation about, you know, how a great number of these issues are too complex to really explain in short amount of time. So looking at, okay, what is the public relations campaign you use? What are the sound bites that define the issue? How is it that we can present this to the public in a manner that they can look at it and go, oh, I understand what you're talking about. Mass holes, not assholes. Yeah. There we are. The other piece that was incredibly encouraging coming out of this was that we got to meet each other. We got to look at each other and say, oh, I've heard of you. Or people got to share, these are the initiatives that we have started in our state. And we can say, ooh, I hadn't thought of that one. And one of the strong examples was that there was a real push on a national level to put into legislation a ban on the use of trans or panic defenses. You know, and particularly looking here in Vermont, we haven't had anyone who's even attempted to use that since 1991. But what New Hampshire shared with me is, oh, we already have language in our, you know, statutes relative to heat of the moment responses that would prohibit this. So we may look at language that provides protection but is an easier sell thanks to New Hampshire. So, So now you can take me back to places that I probably really don't want to go.
Okay. But first I'd like to take you back to the last show, the interview, and I'd like to provide a little context. You recall we had photographer Donna Gottschalk on the show talking about her exhibit, and I mentioned it, but I didn't, you know, we need to provide the exact context. So the name of the show is Brave Beautiful Outlaws, the photographs of Donna Gottschalk, and it's showing at the Leslie Lohman Museum of Gay and Lesbian Art. It's showing now. Pardon me?
In New York.
In New York City, in Soho. And it's showing through March 17th, 2019. So if
you
get
plenty of time to see it.
If you get to New York, stop in and check it out. Now to the intense international news. You recall in June, I sent you, we talked about the Kikuyu refugee camp in Kenya having a gay pride parade, and we, you know, showed pictures and applauded the courage of the people who were marching in that parade. As we recalled at the time, the camp is home to at least 180,000 refugees from more than 10 countries. Since that march, they've experienced a lot of verbal and physical abuse. They staged another march at the UN the UN Refugee Office. And during that, they were beaten with wooden sticks and iron bars. About 20 people were injured. I have a picture now before you, and I hate to show it because it's unpleasant, but this is Mazira Moses, 27, who, following the march on December 11th, was beaten, as you can see in the picture. The so in any event, they have been, 20 of the refugees have been moved out of the camp for their safety, but 170 plus refugees were being shifted to safe houses. So 20 were taken out of the camp, 170 were shifted to safe houses, leaving 150 refugees still at risk by the month's end. They feel that they are not protected by the police, and homophobic violence has been on the rise since that march. So very disturbing story from the Kikuyu refugee camp. There are more than 750 LGBT refugees registered in Kenya with the UN Refugee Program, mostly from Uganda, but also from the Congo, Ethiopia, Burundi, South Sudan, and Somalia. So very disturbing story. Another story I reported on from Greece in September involves the death of an Athenian activist, and four police officers have been charged with inflicting fatal bodily harm on this activist. His name is Zach Kostopoulos. I have a picture now of the Athenians protesting his murder. He was beaten by a mob. There was a fight in the cafe, and so he fled to a shop where they mistook him for a robber and started beating him in the store. He crawled out and was beaten by a mob, and died of a heart attack as a result of the trauma of being beaten. He was a 33-year-old activist for the rights of LGBTQ and HIV-positive people. The police say that they were just restraining him, but there's footage of people beating him up, and the police assumed he was a robber, and, you know, charges have been filed against them, the police. So we'll see how that develops.
Just restraining, a familiar tagline?
Uh-huh, yeah. Uh-huh. Now let's go back to our history and another tragic series of events in Australia, and Keith gave me a article about this several mm-hmm. months ago. In 1988, a young Australian gay man was thrown off a cliff.
Well, they think there were a lot of them, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Either thrown off or chased, so they jumped off as the only means of escape.
Exactly. And one of these young men was studying for his doctorate in mathematics. So his brother, his name is Scott Johnson. There was a picture of him in 1987. He was pursuing his doctorate, as I said. The police on Sunday announced a reward of $1 million Australian dollars for information leading to the perpetrators. He died in 1988. He'd moved to Australia with his partner and had applied for permanent residency. His case has drawn particular attention because of the pattern of homophobia-driven crimes in the 1980s and 1990s in which gay men were targeted by gangs of young people who sometimes forced them off cliffs to their deaths. Former officials have acknowledged that the deaths were not adequately investigated at the time by police officers, many of whom had a reputation for hostility toward gay men. The new reward is the equivalent of about $720,000. It's a tenfold increase. Mr. Johnson's death was originally ruled a suicide. Then they looked at it again and said he might have fallen accidentally. Finally, the courts have ruled that it may have been a hate crime. I have a picture now before you of the brother of Scott Johnson, whose name is Steve, walking at the site of his brother's death. You can see the cliff. This isn't just about Scott's case, Steve Johnson said. I think all these cases need to be looked at. So it's a terrible part of Australian history that needs to be investigated and uncovered. Should I continue or do you want to?
I think we should probably move on.
Okay, I have more cheerful news in my next segment.
Well, good.
I'll be waiting for him.
Okay. I'm not sure I'm going to pronounce her name right, but Mary Queen of Scots stars, is it Saoirse Ronan and Margot Robbie?
I think it's Ciaran. She's Irish.
Yeah.
From Lady Bird.
Yes.
Charon? I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's
anyway.
Mary Queen of Scots.
Yes. And there's much talk about the sexual fluidity and the depiction of sexual gender fluid characters in this film. Some critics say the movie explores the notion of female agency and its flip side, the policing of women's bodies. So we might want to look out for that.
Absolutely.
And then a story about Mike Pence and how he is weaponizing language against the LGBTQ community. These attacks are a coordinated attempt by the White House to strip LGBTQ people and women of their rights. Tara DuPont of Amnesty International writes that this administration is trying to create a world in which trans people don't exist and where women won't have agency over their own bodies, and that religious rights can overrule human rights. The president tried to institute a trans military ban and has been trying to roll back services for trans students. The administration is trying to change the definition of gender in the U.S. in U.S. policy with an attempt by Human Rights and Human Resources to erase gender and define sex as immutable and set at birth, and therefore making trans people invisible and thus not entitled to any rights and protections. So
do we think Trump is on his way out?
I certainly hope so.
I'm taking heart by all the pundits.
I think he might quit.
That's the latest scuttlebutt.
He's a quitter. And Ann Coulter, we all know Ann Coulter. And another, she's a right-wing commentator and troll. And she's ramped up her usual racist, homophobic, anti-Semitic, anti-Muslim propaganda with her assessment of Democrats during an appearance on Laura Ingraham's Fox News show, The Ingraham Angle, on Tuesday. Wait, anybody ever watch that? No.
No.
We're going to be seeing a lot of these disputes in the Democratic Party base because they all hate each other, Coulter said. You have the Muslims and the Jews and the very exotic groups and the black church ladies and the college queers, Coulter said. The only thing that keeps the Democratic base together is they keep focusing on white men. And hating white men is the only thing that the Democrats can agree on. Coulter has a long history of making anti-everything but straight cis white people statements. But some of her anti-LGBTQ, including blaming Hurricane Harvey on the fact that Houston mayor was once a lesbian, Ann Parker. She's also asserted that marriage was not a civil right for same-sex couples. So those are two lovely characters, Ann Coulter and
Laura Ingraham.
Laura Ingraham, oh. Yes. We really, anyway, on a sadder note, a transgender woman was murdered in Detroit on Friday, the 24th. And she is the 24th known homicide of trans Americans this year. The police have arrested a suspect, Kiana Mattel, 36. Her name, she usually went by the name of Kelly Stove. And she was murdered by a 46-year-old preacher. Weathers appeared in court Monday, and bond was set at $1 million. Mattel was well known in Detroit's ballroom scene, and friends posted video on Facebook of her performing. Mattel also, and also near her home, and her mother made the statement that she wanted people to know that because she was a transgender doesn't mean that she was not loved, that she was not cared for. Her mother also said in an interview with NBC News, she has a family who cared for her, who loved her, and I want them to know, I want them to know her. She was educated, she was God-filled, she loved church, she loved others, and as a human being in the United States of America, you have the right to be who you want to be, and you shouldn't be shamed or bullied or persecuted for the choice you make. In the United States against LGBTQ people, and there has been a continued rise on the murder of LGBTQ people. In fact, 3% of hate crimes are up 3% last year, according to the hate crime data on lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people. And so this is according to the FBI, and it's estimated that 4.5% of the general population is being attacked. So anyway, that's a very sad story. And also, this murder took place in the same area that the other person, the other transgender woman was murdered last year. Mm. So a very sad story.
I was going to say, with the FBI hate crime statistics.
Yeah, I mean, you talked about that a bit.
Particularly here in Vermont, they're doing a concerted outreach to get more departments to report, because at this point in time, for a lot of areas, it's voluntary reporting.
Well, yeah, and it says it's up 16%.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I wonder why.
Yeah.
So
it couldn't be our government.
So, speaking of governments, we're about to start another legislative session.
Mm-hmm.
So, looking at the things that might be coming up that we will want to follow, there's going to be a reintroduction of a constitutional amendment for an equal rights amendment.
Yes.
Now, this would have been the trivia question if I had remembered to say it at the beginning of the show. The last time this was proposed was in 1986, and it went down to defeat,
mm-hmm.
or the last time it went out for a vote. The issue that sunk the equal rights amendment was
in Vermont.
In Vermont. Yeah. And Vermont would have been the ratifying state for the U.S. was if you remove discrimination based upon sex, would you then be allowing same gender marriage and gender neutral bathrooms?
Mm.
Familiar?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the first year it has to pass by a two-thirds majority in the Senate, then passed by the House, then in the next biennium, which means 3 years from now, it has to be reintroduced, past both chambers by simple majority before it can go out for vote. Stay tuned because we'll have a lot of reporting.
And because the fact that was never passed is one more national embarrassment that it didn't
slap
go through
in
the
face.
First try.
Yeah.
You know? Oh, exactly. So the other things that are coming up is, and we reported on this a lot last year, was the Ethnic and Social Equity Standards Advisory Group, where we are looking at first putting together a group of people to talk about, if we included curriculum to talk about underrepresented communities in Vermont, what would that curriculum look like? And what this bill would do is identify who are the people who should be at the table to make this decision. And predominantly is the underrepresented communities, and they're appointing someone to serve on this capacity. Oh my, LGBTQ people get to represent ourselves. Anthony Polina, who is a Washington County Senator, is going to be the lead sponsor in the Senate. The other things looking at coming up, again, we're thinking that they're going to reintroduce the equal pay bill that looks at not just, you know, non-discrimination in hiring you, but once you're hired, ensuring that you get an equal salary. That, you know, your, you know, underrepresented status is not used against you, either in promotion, salary, et cetera. Also looking at paid family leave, which there's more data coming out saying how the LGBTQ community in particular needs family leave so we can take care of our partners.
Yeah.
So that we can take care of each other. This will be the hot button issue. Anyone who's watched the news recently, remember Andrew. This is a very unfortunate incident with a young man who committed suicide. Mm-hmm. And his family put out within his obituary to ask the legislature for passage of a waiting period on the purchase of a handgun so that even after you are approved, there is a number of you know, hours, days that you have to wait before you are actually given the firearm. So if it's one of those impulse kind of moves, this will hopefully provide some response. The last issue, and this came up with a conversation today with the Human Rights Commission. Absolutely nobody has jurisdiction over or is adequately tracking bullying. We have no idea how often it happens, what it looks like,
where it's happening most.
And no one has the authority to act in response to it.
Yeah.
The Human Rights Commission in schools, and this is what gets kind of misleading, they can respond to issues of harassment. Well, as the Human Rights Commission says, harassment is such a higher standard and is more difficult to prove.
Right.
And we're missing all of that bullying. What are the things that are happening out there?
And it's much more nuanced.
And also the frequent argument is, oh, well, they're just kids. They're just learning. You know, they really don't mean this.
Yeah.
Say that to the parents who lost a child because they couldn't put up with the bullying. So there's going to be ongoing work that's going to happen over the next year looking at if we were going to address this, who should have jurisdiction, who should collect data, what is the data that's going to be required, and what's the responsibility that's going to be put on school districts to, you not only need to have a policy, you really have to act it out.
Yeah.
Mm.
So you said you had happy news for
yes.
me.
Let's go to Germany, where a third gender option on official documents has been approved for intersex people who do not identify as either male or female and may be born with atypical sexual anatomy. The German government voted this in. Both chambers of parliament have approved the new law, with the Bundesrat upper house giving its backing on Friday. The problem is that LGBT campaigners saying that the measure does not go far enough. They want new laws to make it easier for people who do not identify with the gender they were born with to change it on official documents. So intersex people have been favored by this law, but transgender people are still have a lot to go through to be entirely honored in Germany. Still small progress. Similarly in Israel, the top court has finally ruled for gay parents in a birth certificate fight. The High Court of Justice voted on Wednesday, ruling that the Interior Ministry cannot refuse to write an adoptive parent's name on the child's birth certificate because of the parent's gender. The ruling came in an appeal by two gay men, which I've talked about before, who jointly adopted a son. Mm-hmm. They attempted to procure a birth certificate from the Interior Ministry for the child, but ministry officials refused to write both the men's names as the boy's parents on the certificate. Mm-hmm. So finally, that is going to be permitted in Israel. Now I'd like to turn, if I may, to this trans drama Girl, which has been, it got three awards at Cannes, and it's about Lara, a transgender teenager whose all-consuming desire to be a ballerina is held back by the fact that she was born into a boy's body. And this is based on an actual case. The filmmaker spent a lot of time, read an article about the actual person who experienced this, and the problems are that problems with the film are that once again a cisgender actor is playing a transgender person. You may recall the recent outcry over the casting of Scarlett Johansson as a trans man in Rub and Tug, resulted in Johansson withdrawing, and there was issued in response an aggressive call for inclusion of trans actors in movies and TV shows. Victor Polster, the ballet student who plays Lara in Girl, is cisgendered. He identifies as a man, was born a man. And GLAAD's director of transgender media and representation, Nick Adams, says, if there's such a thing as a male gaze, there's a cis gaze. When you don't know what you don't know, when you don't know where the tropes and cliches are, you run the risk of repeating them. And this is a charge leveled against the director of the film. He held an open casting call. He responds where they saw an estimated 500 people, male, female, and those who didn't identify as either. But the role of Lara and her fellow, dancers, he says, seven trans people auditioned. Unfortunately, the true story is a lot less positive than Girl, explains. His name is DeHunt, I believe that's how you pronounce it, who was determined to make an empowering film in which the character wasn't a passive victim, constantly fending off attacks from her community and school, as the actual character had. So not only is the objection U.S. critics have about the fact that a cisgender person was cast in a transgender role, there were also objections by what seems to be kind of a focus on genitalia in the film. So beware of this. It's going to be promoted widely, I would imagine, and I think it has been nominated for an Oscar for Best Foreign Film. It's from Belgium. So
okay,
be informed about that.
And what's the name again?
Girl,
okay. Well, I'm just going to tell one story, more story, and then I'm going to show a clip, which is a clip from the play that Ann and I both saw in New York called The Prom. And it was in the Macy's Day Parade. And it got some pushback, but mostly it got some very positive feedback. So.
I'm going to get to see the kids.
Yes.
Oh. Are you going to do a story first, or is that?
I'm going to do a story first, and then we're going to show the clip. So, and the last story I just wanted to talk about, which is kind of funny but not funny. But anyway, I'll let you decide. The American flag is set to fly at half staff every month for a year in one bigoted county in to protest gay people having a constitutional right to marry. So on June 26th, the Supreme Court ruled that same-sex couples have a right to marry under the 14th Amendment of the Constitution in all 50 states and around the globe. People celebrated this decision as a historic advancement in civil rights law. But Dent County, Missouri, is actually mourning. the decision, and they plan to lower the American flag at half mast on every public building every month on June 26th until... Every year on June 26th, and they plan to do it again this year because they disagree with the High Court's decision. So...
Let's stay out of that place in Missouri, shall we?
I think we shall.
I think we have a growing list of places that we're not vacationing.
No, that's right.
It sounds like Bermuda. I'm not getting off the cruise sheet again.
No. Bermuda. You could get married there, and then they could, you know, take it away from you. So.
Three times they've ordered marriage.
Well, we don't even.
It seems like more.
So do we have trivia?
No.
The trivia was going to be, you know, we're reintroducing the Equal Rights Amendment.
Oh,
what was the reason it did not pass in 1986? And it was because we became the issue.
Uh-huh.
And actually, it was interesting. It was the first public statement from the Vermont's LGBTQ communities. We drafted a letter that we sent out to every media outlet. There were 14 of us who signed it. And it talked about how we had been targeted during the campaign on the Equal Rights Amendment, and that, you know, enough is enough. We are deserving of respect and equality, and we're asking for it now.
Yeah. And speaking of women's rights, the ERA, I saw a clip about Phyllis Schlafly lately. Remember her?
Is she still alive?
No, but her daughter has taken up her stand and is continuing her mother's fight against... Yes.
Yeah.
Her mother's fight against the Equal Rights Amendment or any such thing ever passing.
Times, they are a-changing, I would say.
So...
We have an interview.
The clip.
We're going to show the clip. And then?
Well, let's show the interview first, and then we'll end with the clip. Do you want to do that?
Well.
You're just trying to confuse Zach.
Oh, sorry.
He's in the booth laughing. But
I think we'll show the clip now.
All right.
One thing you've taught me. How much people enjoy a show, and so you've got me debating how this whole night should go. Let's make it perfect.
Things will look fab in no time. Get ready, folks, cause it's show time. Build a prompt for everyone, show them off. It can be done if music wears. You're on.
I love that clip.
It's so much fun.
I think the two of you could have just leaned over and schmooched.
Yeah. We tried to take a selfie, but it was so weird.
I know. It wasn't flattering, yeah, I have to say.
You know, all our little
so
double chins were showing. Yeah. So
prevented
we forget us. So anyway, now we're going to have the interview with Keith and
Greg Tefft
from 802.
Out in 802.
Out in the 802, and we're going to find out.
And Momentum.
And Momentum, and find out about the organization. So here we go.
Oh, and we're continuing our interview with Greg that you saw the first part back in August. And at the end of that interview, you all of a sudden started talking about a variety of issues to which I looked at you and said, you've got to come back because those
right.
are the things
well,
I would really
time.
Like to.
Right, right.
And some of those were, you had mentioned an organization out in 802.
Right.
And you had started to talk a little bit about some of the initiatives that had just started at the Pride Center relative to LGBTQ elders, which by virtue of my appearance you can tell is an issue of interest to me.
As well as I, yes.
So why don't we start with the out in 802, because that may be the shorter of the two conversations.
Right.
And then you've brought a nice list of things that I should be asking your...
Thanks to Mike at the Pride Center. And
Mike Bensel at the Pride Center. Or we should be sure that they get covered.
Right, yes.
So tell me about out in 802.
Okay. Again, I think I'll just remind folks, I'm Greg Tefft with the Momentum Group at Pride Center.
Your name is, will be below your lovely face.
Okay,
as
very good. Okay. So out in the 802 is a newer name for what was used to be called VGSA.
Okay.
That the original organization started in 1990. It has over 500 members. And I think maybe a year ago they switched the name to Out in the 802 to be more inclusive, and I think to try to cover more of the state, a more of the broad based part of this.
Were there specific populations or specific parts of our community that they were looking to provide outreach or activities that had not been included before?
I don't know for sure, but certainly more parts of the state, trying to get everybody the full LGBTQ community involved, and throughout different parts of the state. So
what types of events does Out in 802 sponsor? Okay.
What they've been trying to do, which is almost every month at someone's home, they have a brunch.
Okay.
So a Sunday brunch, and they've been very successful, usually 30 to 50 people.
Impressive.
So, and they obviously sign up ahead of time, and we try to pick homes that are larger than mine, where we could only, they'd be packed in very crowded. So, but they've been very successful. We do some other outings. We've done a museum tour.
Okay, the brunches are those potlucks?
Yes,
or?
Potluck. Okay. Yeah, potlucks, brunches. So the one in November, we had like 50 people, I think. Yeah, about 50 people
now,
at that one.
Is it a specific, like the third Sunday of each month, or does it?
More varied,
okay.
Right? It's more varied for that, depending on the host schedule, more wherever they're going to have them. Yeah. So at the last one, there's now a, maybe there always was, but now there's out in the 802 steering committee, that a whole group of folks that are trying to energize the group even more, get more people involved, and do different types of things, bowling and. So there's a lot of planning. So there was a sign-up sheet that went around for hosting throughout 2019 of the brunches and other events that people would like to see happening. And then also they were planning, they're already signing up for some other events that game nights and bowling and other things they were trying to do. So
and the steering committee would act as a sort of organizing planning group.
Yeah.
Send out notices to people saying this is the event that we're looking at.
Yes.
Sponsoring.
Yeah. See what the date, what the interest
place.
Is, right?
And how would I know about these
it's,
events?
It's right now. It's pretty much only Facebook. I know they are working on an email, trying to do an email site.
A distribution list.
Right? Or even maybe a central area a web page that you
now
could
do
get
I
to.
Need to be a member of that in 802?
Yes, right. You can ask to join on Facebook. So it okay. is in that
membership
sense. It's
fee?
No membership okay. fee. In that sense, it's somewhat
just,
of a closed
just
group.
My personality
but yeah.
is
yes, your personality would be wonderful, Keith.
You're in big trouble. Okay.
They're very enjoyable. Pretty much all ages, whole spectrum.
You're saying all ages, is that the significant difference between out in 802 and Momentum?
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so Momentum is intended for a more mature group.
Right, 40 or 45 and older, and we've been.
And out in 802, we'll take whatever refresh shows up.
Yes, okay. Yes, right. Exactly. And we've had, at some of the brunches, we've had certainly some 20-somethings, and so we've, I would still say the median age is probably around 50 somewhere, but certainly some younger folks, yes.
Still young. So,
yes, right, still young.
So Mike Bensel supplied this list of things that are happening at the Pride Center relative to LGBTQ elders that he would like you to share.
Yes. So,
as you look at your list.
Excuse me if I'm looking on the list, right. But one of the newest things is there's a Momentum Committee. We formed a Momentum Committee to try to plan events for LGBTQ elders in Vermont. So we met last week, December 11th, and there's another meeting coming up in January 7th. And trying to
get. And the meetings are at the Pride Center?
At the Pride Center, right, to try to get together and come up with some ideas. And at that meeting, I know they're trying to plan some workshops in February.
Okay.
That would be, they're looking at workshops in February at the Pride Center. They were, and please understand, a lot of this is still very much in the planning stage, so please don't take anything as
I'm writing it right down.
Concrete.
Don't.
I'll be in big trouble. They were talking about trying to do those same February workshops in Brattleboro, down in Brattleboro. So they would be
This is on healthcare providers.
Yeah, they were thinking
LGBTQ
of having legal
elders.
Aid, right? LGBTQ elders, AARP.
Coalition of Elders, Medicare fraud.
Yeah, Medicare and legal aid and things like that. So one tentative, very tentative plan is they're thinking of Friday afternoon in Burlington and then Saturday morning down in Brattleboro. So that people that, more of the presenters, were coming from out of town, they could do a connect, they could do Friday afternoon, stay overnight and go down to Brattleboro Saturday morning and then go home.
Okay, now Momentum and the programs at the Pride Center, you have your own Facebook, correct?
Right. Momentum has its own Facebook, and of course, Pride is as a website.
And what Mike Bensel told me the last time I talked with him is that the Pride Center is trying to do a comprehensive calendar, so that if you either went on the website or the Facebook and looked at the calendar, it should tell you not only all the events that the Pride Center is hosting, but everything that organizations are doing statewide. So if I was really interested in Momentum and being part of this organizing committee, I could go onto the Pride Center site and find out when and where you're meeting.
Yep. Yes. The website, I feel personally, is greatly improved in the last few months. We've had a lot of new staff come on board at the Pride Center, and their bios are bios and pictures are on the website now, which is very nice.
Is your picture on the website?
No, unfortunately mine is not.
You will take care of that.
Yeah, right, we'll try to get. But all the full-time staff are on there, and it's really good. And I think it helps all of us, connect faces with names and what they do, because it's been quite a turnover in the last few months.
Okay, one of the things that Mike Bensel had listed is that there are monthly potlucks at the Pride Center now.
Right.
That are being promoted as sort of family events.
Right.
Is this correct?
Family dinners. That's the last Thursday of every month.
Okay.
And
now Momentum has a piece in this.
Yep, Momentum. But anyone can attend, and we've had some, GLAM. We've had all. The very last one was one of our largest groups because the Pride Center staff, they were all presenting or being introduced and talking about their programs and stuff.
This is who I am and this is what I'm hoping to do now that I'm here.
So it was a great turnout for that. You know, it's kind of like a pizza party and potluck, pizza and potluck, and everybody brings a dish. And it was very well, we probably had 30 maybe, I think. Yeah, about 30 people. Yeah,
now, is the intent 25. That this is just social time, or is there also going to be some type of informational forum in conjunction with it?
I would say they're more social time.
Okay.
And, you know, but as you wander around the Pride Center, there's always, you know, information that you can ask from and draw from, and usually one or two of the staff are there to ask questions from, and things like that. So the last meeting was the last November, and the last Thursday in November was a really good, very good turnout, good meeting. Yes, yeah. So,
are there any other initiatives that Momentum is looking at, trying to investigate, or launch relative to elders?
Yes. Well, continued from the February thing, we're looking at a full day in May or June. Part of the steering committee or the Momentum committee, we're looking at a full day in May or June of again focused on elders for just all kinds of events. You know, a full day of workshops and choices again with the AARP. Get some banking in there, some tax folks. That's in the planning stages, but we're excited
estate
about that.
Planning and legal aid, talking right. about what yep. it is Cold, that you have for
yeah.
rights,
yeah.
you know, insurance,
yes.
and yeah. I think there was an event, maybe it's tonight, as we're taping this, where they were going to talk about the types of issues that people from within the LGBTQ communities have when they're trying to obtain insurance.
Right. And I know another big piece of that, certainly for the June or May or June meeting, would be housing. They're going to try to get housing, LGBTQ housing.
You just got Linda's interest.
Yeah, right.
we have frequent conversations about needing a LGBTQ seniors community.
Yeah. And also another... another
you'll investigate that in Fort Lauderdale for us.
I will.
Thank you.
And another thing in Fort Lauderdale is the... there's been some talk of the SAGE group, which is a national group,
mm-hmm.
and I've been assigned the task to find out more about that because they have a big SAGE group in Fort Lauderdale. So that's one of my tasks this winter is to try to figure out whether it would be beneficial to Vermont, the Vermont Pride Center, or would it be a duplicate of Momentum, or would it be...
What do we really get if we become a SAGE practor?
Would it be... different or better than Momentum or not, kind of a...
Other than all of a sudden they seem to be sending me literature and I'm not sure who gave them my name.
Oh, okay. I did not. No, did not. Right.
So my suspect may be Ann.
Could be suspect Ann over here. Yes. Okay. So, and another thing I would just like to mention, there's a lot of services and groups and things, but people have to try to, I know it's hard for some... try to reach out and explore those on their own, I think. Meaning that they're publicized, but you have to kind of search them out for some of them. Mm-hmm. And all the groups, are trying to get better on that, but still I think people have to advocate for themselves a little bit and try to talk to friends, call the Pride Center, try to search out on Facebook or something until more of them are email-based as well as Facebook. So just wanted to bring that up. So.
Well, I heard you when you were talking about out in 802 and trying to be more of a statewide presence. Momentum in the Pride Center in relationship to elders is trying to do the same thing.
Right. Yes. Yeah. So we're trying to reach out.
This is what we have to offer. How can we do it in your community?
Yes.
Or how can we extend this service to you in a manner that's meaningful? So in our last minute.
Oh wow, that went quick.
It did the last time. Which is why you came
okay,
back.
And right.
Why, when you come back from Fort Lauderdale and are ready to report on SAGE.
And SAGE, right, and other things. And
any last things that you would like to share relative to Momentum, Elders, the Pride Center, how much
it is going to be nice to be sitting in warm, sunny weather in Fort Lauderdale in a week.
And looking forward to that, right.
Okay.
Yeah. But I we're really working on a lot of the elders' issues and also trying to get spread out throughout more of Vermont. So we're trying to look at different models where that might, you know, where that might benefit.
And they really need to hear from you.
Yes, yep. So. Please. Yeah, so there's all kinds of things at the Pride Center, you know, that you can email, contact numbers.
Like we have your email address below your lovely face.
Which that helps and suggestions, right, and all that So.
So thank you, and I'll be waiting for your return from Fort Lauderdale.
Okay. Thank you, Keith. Yes.
Well, that was fun, very informative.
And he'll be back for part three in the spring.
Yes, and there are a lot of interesting information for people who are looking for things to do, places to go, and people to see. So on that note, have a good holiday, and remember to resist.
With humor.
And you'll see us in the new year.